team in this game. If he's able to get that shove onto Rumble, I mean, you mentioned it, the theorizing of this matchup. We don't get to see a lot of Rumble versus Jace. Gimgun feels pretty comfortable about it.
Yeah, he picked into the Jace, right? And I would actually think coming into this matchup, I would prefer to beat the Jace, honestly. Yep. It's just like Rumble comes towards you, up, eat away, and you negate a lot of that damage unless he lands the electric harpoons on you first. So it's actually fairly difficult to make that matchup work, I would think, especially in terms of itemization with Hexdrinker. But we shall see, because Gimgun is a professional player, and I have a lot of faith in Gimgun. I'm a Gimgun fanboy in this series.
Yeah. I would say that the Rumble pick in this situation is for not only for the team composition, but also for the 2v2. Because Rek'Sai, Rumble, if they can get the 2v2 going, Jace is really... I mean, as an obvious point, it's fairly squishy. Ooh. Get him!
He's going to walk up the river. He's safe.
That was the most RNG plant I have ever seen.
Suspicious.
In my life. Yeah.
Yeah.
Was able to just get right in there, so they had to actually move away from the plant because it would get seen.
Because they would pop it. Yeah, Root Call lands onto Zhaoyu. This is going to be a nice bit of damage. It will send him back to base, but as long as he recalls a Baron now, he's fine. Are we seeing anything out of the ordinary in terms of those masteries? I don't think so.
No.
Deathfire Touch on Rumble.
This time, I really do like the Thunderlords on Jace because it's a squishy matchup, and if you can get on top of him and blow him up, then that's easy. It was questionable last time around because it was up against the
Poppy.
Yep. And Poppy, you have to be smacking a lot of times. Fervor's is much better in that scenario.
Yeah. Thunderlords is good up until Poppy's first back. And then Poppy doesn't take any damage anymore. So if you can crush it, then good on you, but it is hard to make that so. Swift, he's doing the rounds. He's starting on the top side this time, so we get to see another route from him instead of the bot start. But he will wander on down there as well and take away this red buff most likely and get all that health back with the smite.
It's interesting that he didn't actually smite up the blue buff going forward. You'd usually at least see them take blue buff so they can move on to the next couple patches, because he needs to get one more camp off, which is probably going to be the red for him to be useful. Yeah. It's just you do need a lot of mana for you to be able to be setting that up. So I guess he's just gonna go straight towards topside and be heavily influencing that side of the map.
It makes sense, right? Especially with V and Gimgun going head to head in a volatile matchup of two carries. So it makes sense even to be there for a counter gank on the side of Zhaoyu. And now we have blue buff, so mana issue is no longer a problem.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see if he actually does get something done. Yeah, there's the on the way ping. We all know V knows.
Gonna be rough for that Rumble. I mean, Rumble was looking for the 2v2 for himself, but man, if Swift's coming in and he already has double buff, that's gonna hurt.
It's gonna come down to this Root Caller. It has a nutty range as well. He's gonna have to back away. He goes into the bush to cut it off. He waits for it, but sidestep from Gimgun. He's getting battered away by these auto attacks, but does make it out. So nice patience on Gimgun there.
Yeah, and Swift, even though he wasn't able to get the kill, I mean, he's kind of looking for it. Swift.
Whew. Oh, sugar seed up in time.
Yeah, but he was able to scout out this camp here as well, so I think he has smite up. He does. He can just take it out and walk away, so he didn't even lose experience for looking for that play.
He did not know. He's going to walk back up to the top lane, use that scrap shield to fly up there a little bit faster.
Oh, they're pinging for it.
And yeah, Swift is going to stay around. He was thinking, will he TP? But now he knows he's walking, but he's already committed to it. He might as well stay, and Gingu's going to walk right past the bush with his bot lane, where the damage is opening up more. Has Malefic Visions on top of him. Oh, he's going to have to use the heal. Yeah, those minions may have just finished him off there from the Voidlings. But Swift was not able to intercept the Rumble in time. Zhaoyu gets the knock-up, gets the damage. But double buffs on both of these players. But the Flame Spits are chasing down V. And he has to use two of the skies. But this is precarious. The flash, the knock-up once more. Trigger Seed will keep him alive. Gets a slowdown onto Gimgun as well. Electro Harpoon, where it's going. It's going on to V. And he's found his kill. He'll just burn him to death. First blood to Gimgun.
And that's going to hurt. We talked about the 2v2 and how it should work in favor of Gimgun and Zhaoyu, and it just didn't work well because, or at least it worked well for them, but it didn't work well for V and Swift because they were pretty greedy. They were looking for that. They wanted to be able to catch Rumble coming back in. We couldn't see, but overall, Gimgun did get to that tower safely, and Zhaoyu had the sense of mind to come topside and help him out. So that was really solid from Zhaoyu. Zhaoyu is just getting better and better every time we see him.
Yep, Xiaoyu in coordination with Gengun in the top lane, and that could have not really gone to a better person for that first blood, especially, as we said, this top lane matchup in these terms of carries. That being said, Gengun is behind in farm, and Jace will get this full wave as it crashes towards him, so it's not the end of the world, but in terms of just keeping Gengun even at the very least is really nice to have.
Yeah, and you might just see Xiaoyu look to continue to prioritize this side. Swift, if he's smart and he's already on this side of the map, that's good for him to recognize that, you know what, I can continue to look to this side, mostly because of how far Zubin and Soulmate are pressuring up in this lane. So let's see Gengun.
He wants to convert this into a mid lane gank. Valkyria just has the mana for it, barely, only just got it in time as Gengun almost burns him in that mid lane, burns both of his summoners.
That was really proactive of him, and that's really good on Gengun, even though he's going to miss out a little bit in CS, his lane is in a bad spot. If he goes back top lane, it's going to be unfortunate, but that just gives Republic peace of mind.
Swift, a little bit trigger happy on the root caller, means that Zubin will make his way out. So again, once again, not panning out for him and his team. Xiaoyu will see him, and as will Swift. Ooh. Sees him on the tremor sense, it will back away. Yeah, nice sidestep there on a relatively slow projectile, and that was funny. I already have this one set up, so he'll take the one away from him.
That's always hilarious to see. You just suddenly they just vanish in front of your eyes, freed off into the wild, which I don't even know where they would go. Nope. But I'm not gonna.
If that's their home.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm just not even gonna argue with the lore.
Like the captive animals, but whatever. It's lore.
And Gengun. You can't argue against the lore. No. It's essentially science here.
No. You. Yeah. Yep. Sure. Swift on his way to the top lane now. Let's see if he can make this one work. He still has his flash, so if he wants to go balls to the wall aggression, he can do. But he's actually going to path towards the mid lane as Republic is pushing up. Xiaoyu is hovering around the top side. He's not in the tremor sense just yet, but yeah. Many on the way pings, so Gengun knows he's on his way up there.
And that's the struggle with this mid lane. Xiaoyu did a good job in looking to hover around it, because that was a really tough place for Republic to be. And he's going to continue to get shoved off here. I mean, it's going to be slowly shoving into him, so that's just fine. But Republic has to constantly watch out because, you know, even though Coco doesn't have his exhaust, he can immediately get blown up with Swift. So Swift has a lot of playmaking potential here. Thankfully for game talents, not a lot of plays are coming through.
Feeling in the mid lane again, trading blows. Swift, Xiaoyu knows he's there.
Xiaoyu's just watching him. Just saying, keep away.
Get out of my jungle. But it's V following after. He's low on mana, but if there's any CC landing, he'll be able to get him in range with the root caller. Regardless, Swift is just being annoying, smites away the camp. Red Buff was there, but the fact that Gengun's also in the jungle, in the vicinity, with level 6, makes it a little bit more precarious.
Yeah, looks like Game Talents might look to commit onto this one. They don't want to lose their red buff, so it feels like they probably don't have a choice in the matter.
Well, no. Yeah, and that's two red buffs over to Nuvi.
Ooh.
You very rarely have that choice in the matter. Big crit onto LWX along with a headshot.
I love that. That trap placement, you see it a lot with Caitlyn's, because on the blue side of the map, it happens even in the purple side of the map. You just try and hide it behind the turret structure itself. Until LWX probably forgot it was even placed. Probably didn't see the animation.
Yeah, there's another one that went down there. You just heard it be placed, but you can't see it.
Yeah, and so that's always a trouble, especially since you're always going to be under tower.
Oh! There it is! We just talked about it. He has to heal out of it as well.
Yeah.
He needs to turn his game sounds up.
He really does. Maybe it's the white noise stopping him, but overall, there's no excuse.
Stop giving him excuses,
I'm sorry.
He should have stepped up.
I tried.
Just don't get hit by it again. We're watching you. Xiaoyu. Coming into the bot side, and more sticks around. His ADC went back. The flash from Soulmate pops him with the Malefic Visions, and it comes. That was overkill. You didn't need to do that, Republic.
It's a bit much.
V comes down and teleports right into the trap.
There's no one going to be coming in.
Yeah, no, it's just him at the moment. Coco does have his package, so Zubin's the one I'm looking towards to maybe get called off, but he's a little too close to GT for their comfort, so we'll back off for now.
Game Talents looking really hot right now. This is actually Xiaoyu. I mean, I'm happy that we're just taking a little bit of a focus on him. Yeah, I don't know why he was starting up on blue buff for whatever reason. He has to stop doing it now because his mid laner is nowhere nearby. I mean, I think mid laner definitely has a say in that
one. Yeah, probably.
But yeah, he was able to make that play and really caught Newbie off guard. So Swift is in a tough spot where a lot of the early pressure he's made hasn't turned into anything. In fact, Game Talents are ahead.
And something that was actually really nice and small there from Zubin is he placed one other trap just behind the tower, exactly where the TP would land, because the TP always lands the closest to your base.
Yeah.
So they were setting up for that dive even before anything happened, you know? So just that preemptive ward, which is such a tiny, small, minute detail, was really nice to see.
Yeah, that's always good. I think the trap placements have been A+ here so far. Mm-hmm. Nice to see here from Zubin. I mean, Zubin, maybe he's looking for...
An S-.
Yeah.
Get that Hextech piece. But I was looking towards Xiaoyu as he goes right into the enemy jungle once more, places down the control ward right where he arrives, so he knows no one saw him. And he will look for another dive on the bot lane perhaps, but this has been read out by Coco, because where else could Rek'Sai be? And more knows it's happening.
Ooh.
So we're seeing Republic caught in the middle lane, Gravity Field comes out, not stunning up Coco. He's gonna do the quick dash off away, and this is a little bit dangerous as he goes for this 1v1 once more.
Oh.
Republic does not have his ultimate. So he's just gonna do a little bit of a dance.
The Skullcrab is in between both of them too, so
break it up.
Yeah, get it out of there. That was actually really fun to see. That was a 200 IQ play coming in from UB, recognizing that, say, you know what? They're definitely going to be looking to bring Republic into this play, and they cut him out. They're saying, you know what? We're going to stop you in this Silk Road. You're not going to be able to take your trade out to the bottom lane.
Not happening today. Close it up. Wrap it up.
Mm-hmm.
Send your business elsewhere. Republic clears out the minion wave in the mid lane. And he's getting to the place where he's starting to scale up. You know, the problem with Victor is he suffers in that early stage, and he had so many kind of hits towards how fast he can clear out a mini wave. I just saw that hit in the mid lane, which is a little bit scary, and flash up red. But he's gotten to that point where he's got the upgrade on his Hextech core.
You got to stop taking those traps.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that was a good point. I mean, the Hex core, there was a nerf a long time back that really did hit Victor hard, which was the first back, which meant that Victor, a lot of the times, would either go back for a second Doran's Ring because of how hefty the early cost was to his Hex core. But he was able to actually get that really quickly. So now that means that he's able to wave clear a lot more effectively with his E. That's great for Victor. I'm surprised he was able to get that point. And you can kind of thank that to Gimgun, who went in for that early roam mid. So that worked out really well for Game Talents, and they're kind of riding that one. So now they do have a lot of... They have a pretty big strength coming in the mid lane now. And it's continuing through the bottom lane. They're at a great point for themselves right now.
It's true. They have the advantage. And they have the ability to stall. It seems like complete control over the game is here for them. And Xiaoyu still unable to take these camps away from Swift, but Swift has not been able to make any of these ganks happen. He's arrived, he's stemmed the bleeding, but still, the bottom tower will eventually fall to Zubin. There you go, last hit, and 650 gold over to him, and yet more advantages to GT. And this early game pick that we were heralding as something that could solve their problems has not really done what we wanted it to for Newbie for now.
Yeah, and so for now, I mean, Newbie, the mid and top lane. I mean, Jace is still doing okay. He's not really pressuring anything at this point in time, right? So Gimgun is doing quite well for himself. It's just the picks coming in through Newbie. They're not really seeing much value, mostly in the bottom lane, because in theory, Ezreal's great, or at least decent into Caitlyn, because when you take control of the wave, you should be able to poke it a little bit and have a decent save. That's just not that has not been happening, especially since Xiaoyu was able to start to pressure out and was able to get that gank in the bottom lane too. So Game Talents really looking to play like a team early in the game, and that's something we've never seen from them.
From Newbie side, they have completed those hex shrinkers, which will be nice in their individual matchups, and if they get into these skirmishes, not necessarily these 5-on-5s, because I definitely would give the strength still over to GT at that point, with Zubin now completing that first big item and power spikes across the board, really. But GT don't need to do anything proactive. They can just clear out these minion waves and keep doing the GT thing.
Yeah, Newbie still has a little bit of an advantage in the mid lane only. In the mid lane, they can just continuously look to pressure mid and look to maybe take mid lane turret, which is great that Xiaoyu recognized that and said, hey, you know what, I'm going to clear out vision here. And that means that Kokoro suddenly has to worry about getting ganked. And meanwhile, he's doing it in a safe position because Zubin and Soulmate is actually just rotated pressure topside. So Game Talents are working by the book. I wonder if they have a little bit of a cheat sheet under their computer.
Yeah, what is this?
Computer.
Cheating for the test here, Raz.
What's going on here?
Case just written something in the arm. Someone check that real quick.
Yep.
Because they are playing like a completely different team. They have this game plan written out, and they are following it by the letter. So this is good to see, honestly, from Game Talents, because expectations coming into this game, we spoke about it so much in Game 1, but it's worth reiterating that no one had these expectations apart from apparently the fan vote, that GT would
they saw something we didn't.
Yeah, apparently 70% of them, no less. So they knew somehow.
Yeah,
insider information.
Game Talents going into the set, absolutely just at my mind had no chance. At the very least, what they had to show to us was that they're improving, but they're doing more than that. Not only are they showing improvement, they're showing improvement, well enough improvement to be able to take wins. I mean, it's too early to say for this game, but they already got one win, and they're at the very least forcing this to game three. And this game is already looking really good for Game Talents.
It is. This is, you know, Game Talents continue at this pace. Obviously, it's very early on into the game, 15 minutes. They just need this one more win to go their way. I just like listening to Rumble.
Yeah,
like,
I mean, Rumble
I don't get
sounds,
too many chances to listen to the Super Galaxy skin on the Chinese server.
That's true.
I need him to die as well, and just stay silent for a second.
Yeah, you gotta
deflating the Rumble.
When those moments happen, I feel like it'll take a while before it does happen. But currently, you know, we're just gonna hear him bullying the matchup, or at least farming up. Okay, he's behind, but not too far behind. He's gonna look towards his Liandry's. We've actually been seeing a lot of Rumbles lately. Go for just holding on to the Zonya's component, just for the armor, just for a little bit of armor that scales up, but then go towards the two flat magic penetration items, not only in the boots, but at the Liandry's Torment as well.
Swift's contributions to this map so far have been placing down random brushes and lanes, and annoying Zhaohui.
It's very hard for this champion Ivern to actually do much when they're behind. Coco keeps landing skill shots and you're gonna get somewhere. But Swift can't really do much. He tried early and it didn't work out for him, and now he's falling behind in farm. He's actually trying to get to a point where his redemption works. Maybe then they'll look for a team fight. But up until that point, it's not looking good for them.
It's crazy how just a couple missed root callers in the early game can completely change how Ivern operates as a pick just in the composition. Until later on, this is a game when you get tier 2 Daisy and she's up like literally 99% of the game.
Mm-hmm.
And you do get that 6v5 situation, which could be good for them, but they have to be ahead. You know, it's a great snowballing pick. You can start sieging towers, you can start getting these picks. Like, Daisy feels really oppressive, but when you're behind, you get a situation like this, so... Again, just something to keep in mind of while we see Gimgun chasing down V. Second Harpoon doesn't land, which is maybe a little bit nice, but Republic's here chasing him down, lands the ultimate. Oh. There's the Equalizer cutting off the escape route, but he still has a way upwards, but he's getting burnt to death by Gimgun. Republic's the one picking up the kill, and that was a simple kill in the bottom lane.
Yeah, it was a bit of a, I scratch your back in the early game, you scratch mine. And so Victor, now that they've actually pushed in on a wave, that means that they can get a little bit of damage on this turn, not enough. They're going to back away entirely, but that was actually a really good play. A little bit risky from Republic, because he had also had the option to go to the top side of the map and secure this tower. What ended up happening was they took the risky option of being able to get two plays at the same time, and it worked out well for them.
I need to start thinking about G2 as a different team, at least in this matchup.
Yeah.
Because I look at them and I'm just like, ah, yes, but they picked up that tower, but something's going to go wrong. But if you look at this objectively, that they aren't GT, it's like they just picked up two towers by themselves. They're loading gold onto Zubin. He's picked up both of those solo tower kills. Mid lane's doing massively, like 2-0. Top lane, your big playmaker Gimgun, 1-0-1. Like, everything is going right for this team.
Exactly. I actually think that if you just covered up Zubin's name, he wouldn't be Zubin. He's been doing so well for himself, keeping to the plan. And here's the thing, Game Talents have been using that dual lane very well. They've actually been playing towards that lane. Xiaoyu has decided to either gank the lane, which has never happened before. They just kind of let that lane die. And this time they're playing through Zubin as a winning lane. And so he's actually had his time to shine. He's 0-0-0, but 0-0-0 constantly pressuring LWX.
Now Republic saying, it's his time to shine. Popping the disco ball, popping the ace in the hole. One more zap will do it. He'll flash after. So he gets the power transfer and a quick kill onto LWX. But this is still almost a perfect game from them. More opening up with the Strangle Fawns.
Oh.
And it will be a kill over to Zarya. He actually jukes down, so he gives it to the support in the end.
Yeah, that's not too bad. And one big thing is Swift was able to get the redemption, but wasted a little bit. It's a low cooldown, so when people start to reset back onto the map, it'll come back up again. It's not too bad. But that just means that right now, if you're Game Talents, sure, you lose one kill, but man, Victor's actually getting to a strong point right now. Coco.
He's lying in wait.
He waited.
Just yeah, he waited, and unfortunately, Soulmate decided to take a U-turn and did not turn right down the river. So
yeah,
he doesn't get his kill.
And that's the risky point of looking to engage on top of a Malzahar. He's squishy, you know, you can probably get him, but he's close to a bush, and he's probably close to his team. If you don't have the vision to really control, or at least check out his team, you're going to be committing time that you really don't have, especially since Soulmate can extend it with an ulti. So
yep.
Overall, that was a good play for him to just back away. He was looking for an opportunity, saying, hey, you know what? 20% chance he walks my way. Didn't
sure.
happen.
I mean, why not take it? You know, yeah. It's not like a big loss over to the team. And at this point in time, you do need to take those small victories where you can. Because as it is, you know, GT are essentially getting everything apart from that Mountain Dragon and that one kill they managed to pick up in the top lane. But next Dragon will also be Mountain. So GT would like to get their hands on that one. In terms of silver linings, though, for Newbie, they have hit double Triforce Spike. So that is really big for them, as well as the Maw of Man Waters in the top lane. So if there was any time that they can look for a fight, look for a skirmish, it would be now.
Yeah, I actually think that, with that being said, we see one Power Spike coming from Gimgun. He actually finished the Zonias really early, which we don't see a lot from the Rumbles here. So, you know, holding on to the Liandry's Torment, not going to happen now. Probably, I guess it's going to be the finish on the third item. That means he has a lot of playmaking potential here. He can probably look for something crazy. He's already looking to roam towards this mid lane. Maybe that's his next focus. Lumen, though.
Daisy has been unleashed. He'll flash away and 90 caliber net on top of that. And while Swift War prance and pounce towards the team, they'll back away. Coco has located Republic, or is it the other way around? Republic throws down the ultimate, but Coco comes out significantly ahead. Now he'll look towards Soulmate and Zhao Yu blocking up these ultimate shots. Ace Nahal will be returned onto more as that massive heal comes out from Swift.
That was a great play from Newbie. 21 minutes into the game, they can't get Baron just yet. But man, for them to be able to turn this game or at least get the control that they do have means that Swift is going to be a little bit relevant now. Ooh, good poke here.
And this is the team of Newbie starting to turn online. So yes, they dropped a lot of these kills. Yes, they were maybe 2,000 gold behind, but these power spikes in terms of these champions are something that you can never overlook for Newbie. Clearing out this top wave, Coco, he gets this to himself, which I don't see anyone else around to steal it from him.
Yep.
That will be a massive gold influx towards him.
Yeah, so this is turning into Newbie's favor. On top of that, not only is a double Trinity Force coming online and working well for both Coco and LWX, but also now that Swift, he's been farming up, you know, he wasn't able to get the early game going for his team, but he's actually at a really good point where not only does he have redemption, he's about to finish his Locket of the Iron Solari. Mm-hmm. So, because, you know, if you're Ivern, you don't need to worry too much about your own personal HP, so he didn't finish up his own jungle in camp. So that's really solid for Swift. That now that he has this control towards Baron, they have a lot of damage. The possibility, especially with that one Earth Dragon towards looking towards Baron, is really strong. So GT, they have to watch out for that. They have a lot of control mid. They can't let this tower go.
The Ring of Brushes have been brought up by Swift, but that's a little close. I usually want it a little bit further back because at that point, the brush does essentially nothing.
Yeah.
Because the tower just reveals inside it. But
I feel like it works in favor of Zeus.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, this is actually really helping out GT. They're just sitting that brush and stuff. And it was like, wait, why?
Why did
Hello?
You do this?
Swift?
What? It works so well for Zubin. Not only does it help his passive procs, yep. but it just legitimately, he put it on top of the traps.
Yep.
Just, all right.
He's actually just trolling his team.
Yep.
They've evaporated now for now. Don't do that again, Swift.
I'm watching you. Yep. A little bit crazy.
Alright, GT back to pushing down the mid lane. The tower's still up, but it is fairly low. Republic does have his Chaos Storm, so he'll try to land it onto a nice squishy target.
Oh.
Daisy coming in there, use the Root Caller to get in range, but she's smited down. She'll take a trip back to base. V called out. Big Equalizer comes out. He'll flash away before knocking Gimgun back towards the enemy team. Swift coming in there. Zubin getting chased down. Coco popping off. But that is the exhaust down onto him, so he'll stop for now. Nice knockup from Zhao Yu. He'll flash after. That's another kill onto Gimgun. This is quickly going wrong for GT. A Newbie come back into this game swinging.
And somehow Victor was able to survive this, but that means Newbie now are able to come out, take this tower, set up towards Baron. I don't think they can take it yet, but I guess like they're going to keep going down mid. So this is a little bit of a parade for them. They're not going to stop.
I mean, you say that, Raz, but we're 24 minutes into the game. A lot longer than maybe it has felt just because of how slow this game has gone so far. But they are pushing up the mid lane. Nice chunk of damage on towards that. But we are getting to the point in the game where you could look towards a Baron play.
And let's take a look at Republic. Republic had to flash away, but he's still incredibly low. But here's the biggest point. Zubin's positioning, he has to walk in deep to be able to get the autos off, with me and Coco got an amazingly easy flank, and it's not going to stop here because Xiaoyu thinks he could stop him. No, you can't do much damage to this man. Gets an elder ulti off and just decides he's not going to go after Victor. It's going to be too much of a chase.
Mm-hmm. It's Coco time, turning up in this mid lane with this Corki pick. 3-0-0, rapidly approaching a second item now from what was essentially just a Trinity Force and a Hex Drinker. So 5-5 and kills, but only 1,000 gold in, and not even that right now. And with this Mountain Dragon spawning, newbie probably feeling a lot better about contesting this.
Ooh, and the line of traps are there. Even though the ward does catch a mount, it does not matter. Newbie cannot walk over these traps. If they do, it's not going to be too good for them.
No.
But if they can actually wrestle control of the Scuttle Crab, who decides to hand himself over. Nah, just kidding.
Nobody even cares about it anymore.
They can't go for it.
Dragon's going over to Xiaoyu. I mean, it's still in place where it could be smited away. An early smite, but it will still go to Xiaoyu. No one has died just yet, but Gimgoon turning up the heat. Double redemptions comes down. What does it mean? It means someone's going to die in the form of Xiaoyu to start this one off. Get the staring contest down from Soulmate, and he will get 1, 2, and Coco returns with a kill. Looking for this cleanup. Gimgoon locked in place. Frostbomb doesn't land, but Coco is waiting on top of him. Gimgoon survives on the sliver of HP and lands an Electro Harpoon, but the Valkyrie's up, and we'll find him with a Gatling Gun. A little bullet just nibbed him on the end there, but that was a 3-for-3 trade with the Mountain Dragon over to GT.
Yeah, if you're game talents, that's the best win you can actually get in that situation. Not only do you get your Mountain Dragon so newbie doesn't get a second one, but now you actually take a team fight. Just take a look at Zubin here. Gets locked down. Decides to actually walk into the fight. Just pop himself over so he can actually have some impact and is able to take down more. But just take a look at the three-man strong of Coco, Swift, and of course, I guess Ezreal kind of got locked down. But that was a great moment from Gimgoon, able to trade a kill and back away from that entirely. So I think game talents, they played as well as they could have in that situation. But it was just a really tough fight for them.
Mm-hmm. After all of that, though, you have to still look towards where the kills have gone, and 6 of them are on Coco. So Coco can really get rolling in these team fights as long as Soulmate doesn't lock him down. That is a concern for the next couple until he gets to the point where he can afford, he has that extra cash, you know, for the QSS. But at that point, it will be a little bit awkward because, he can just walk up and just...
yeah, demolish you.
Yeah.
That's a good point. And here's another point. It's actually Caitlyn's looking to get the second attack speed item in the Rapid Fire Cannon. So it's interesting mostly because that pushes game talents a little bit further in terms of when they're going to be feeling comfortable to take these fights. It might not be too bad simply because the only armor coming forward is going to be based in Ivern, and it's not even that too much. He has supportive items mostly. So he's just pretty much called an audible to say, I don't need to go towards a Lord's Dominic Regard. I don't need to really go towards a Last Whisper in general. So he's finished it up. He's gone for that Rapid Fire Cannon. Let's see how comfortable he is to actually walk up forward and actually and auto.
Just poking back and forth, controlling over this bush, and GT do get control over it for now. Swift.
Oh, here comes that annoying point in the game.
Yeah, just covering up Baron. Is it there? Who knows? GT cannot see within that pit anymore, but it's not something that newbie can necessarily rush, but it does force GT to be in the same area where it allows Coco to... that could have been scary. He didn't have vision, of course, but yeah. Coco and V, a lot of poke from these two players, so just want GT to be in the place where they line themselves up and they can start playing dodgeball.
Yeah, they're going to have to play a pretty good game of dodgeball. Game towns are not too bad in a situation in dealing with that if the Baron situation does arise. I mean, Soulmate, you got to get out of there now. They're going to lose this tower, but at the very least, they have the AoE from Gimgoon to be able to deal with it if the situation comes through. But still, newbies liking how they actually can play with this turret push. They're going to go for the next one.
Sure, they're going to keep this up. Daisy's still alive, and they have that one hero minion that is reducing the armor of this tower.
As
long as that stays alive, it has just died, but they can crack this open. And that one minion, literally by itself, allowed newbie to go onto this inhibitor. After all of that, 29 minutes in, and just these tiny things going wrong for GT that are resulting in newbie opening up this game for themselves and reversing this momentum play. They're poking slowly against this inhibitor. Republic's low on health, but he does have his ultimate. V has been opened up on by the Nether Grasp. Republic wants to get this ultimate in. Zhaoyu with the flank play knocked up. Both Coco and Swift. Gimgu wants to come in from around the side, chasing down more. Hits the E down, and he is limping away. But there's no way he's going to get out of this one. Azen Hall starts resetting, and V needs to get out of vision range because you know Zubman's going to lock in, and you know he will not be able to get the kill. Oh, Republic finds him, and that's the big punish out there from GT that has swapped the momentum back into their favor and will allow them to go for this Baron.
Yeah, what a beast Xiaoyu is. He was able to get that two-man knock-up. Now it's all up to LWX to make this play happen. The sole member of the team to be able to come
in. He has his ultimate, Raz.
Can he do it? I don't think he's silenced. He can't do it.
He's going to turn it on to Republic and try and get this one kill, but it's not going to happen. Too much damage. The ace comes out for GT, and that push in mid lane was just simply not worth it.
What a twist of fate over there. That was ridiculous. For Game Talents to be able to come back into that, they had a lot of playmaking potential, but for Xiaoyu to be able to make that play happen allowed Republic to get that damage, allowed Gimgun to actually be able to impact that fight with his ulti. So that was such a massive play from Xiaoyu, and he's been playing so well in this set so far.
Talk about a twist of fate. At the same time, this is a new dawn for GT in this game. Getting that Baron, momentum back in their favor, pushing down mid lane, able to get all of these towers now for themselves, and sieging with Zubin is only ever going to open up more gold for themselves unless an engage happens from Newbie.
This is just a sick game here for Game Talents, where technically they're ahead, but all of these pokes are just going to demolish them, and they don't even know where the poke is coming from. What's happening?
This is cheating.
Zubin's walking, playing that game. It's okay. Get in there, Zubin.
Never before in the history of dodgeball has this been utilized. Never did they have an Ivan to hide their players.
What a game! If you were able to play a game of dodgeball
in the pitch black,
just in
and
actual
darkness.
And they
had night vision goggles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's some scary game. I'd be down for it, honestly.
That's true. That would actually be very fun. We'll see who's up for it. Yeah, I'm sure that probably exists.
Yeah.
There's no way you just thought about that on the fly on a broadcast of League of Legends for that not to be thought of another human on this planet.
Yeah, someone must have thought that.
Regardless, here comes Daisy. Daisy's back, ready for some more fun. Mid lane tower still being pushed in, but it's actually Gimgun who's jumping down the bottom lane tower. He gets that inner tower. They'll keep on pushing, and on a dime, GT are able to make this work for themselves. Swift is getting chased down by this laser storm.
Yeah, and this is good enough pressure. They're able to get two turrets off that, and right now, Game Talents, they should be happy with what they have, unless if they feel ballsy and look to go in for another tower. But it doesn't seem safe. So right now, for Game Talents, that is a great use of Baron. It's halfway done, so I mean, it's just a little bit more than halfway. So you still have a little bit more to utilize it for. I guess they're going to take a second Earth Dragon, though.
We've had a good day for Earth Dragons.
Yeah.
Maybe even a good week. I feel like we've seen so many triple Mountain Dragons. So many get the statistics on that one. But it's definitely encouraged teams to fight a lot more and go for these objectives. And at the end, it's only really going to favor GT. 32 minutes in. Again, gold gap opened back up to 6,000 gold. And we are at that crest of over 35 minutes where that Elder Dragon will now spawn. And we'll get a fight over that one as well. So Newbie, I don't think they'll be able to utilize Coco's package, but at the very least, they'll get this bottom lane tower for themselves. So the smallest of consolation prizes.
Yeah, and just think about how much that Elder Dragon would mean for these teams. For both of them, specifically GT, they have a lot of abilities to be able... Oh, just kidding. Get out of there. That's not going to mean too much. But going back to the points, and Xiaoyu just was slightly startled.
Yeah, startled is the right word, though. It's just like he has drawn the line in the sand and... I guess I'll just walk over it.
Yeah, but getting two Earth Dragons, if you are able to get an Elder Dragon, that means that these towers are going to fall very quickly. Incredibly quickly. So that just means one team fight win. Could actually mean not a win fight, a one game, but definitely inhibitor.
Push up in the bottom lane for sure. Yeah, I mean, they still have to crack open this base. Gimgun's going to do his part in top lane.
Never seen a split pushing rumble.
Yeah, do this
successful.
Well. Yeah, he's taken many a tower in this game. Maybe too many. But there we go. There's another one in the top lane. GT will be happy with that. Now it's just this inner shell of the turtle that they need to crack.
Ooh.
And it is the hardest. But Zubin is hurting.
All eyes are on Zubin. I mean, Republic can actually take a few pokes from Coco, but not Zubin. Zubin will be... he's a bit paper. If he takes... ulti from Coco, he's just gonna shred. He's gonna die.
Yep.
It's not gonna be that bad, but he's definitely gonna get poked out. So, he was able to dodge that one just a little bit, but I love the traps coming through. Zubin!
Zubin called out more. Big play from him. Knock up lands onto Republic, but Coco is low enough on mana where He doesn't really want to commit on that one. So what could have been a good play just burns those two summoners from Zhuvan, which, to be fair, is pretty big.
Yeah, so this is ridiculous here. Someone needs to do something, preferably, right? With these with these bushes.
That's true. There are too many damn bushes. Here comes Daisy.
This is good combat. They're actually just pushing it off. I think Republic even has ulti, so he can actually...
She's alive. Yeah, observers know what's up.
Yeah, and he's going to heal up. Definitely just going to...
Yep, there you go.
That's nice.
Well designed.
Yep.
Here comes more. Here goes more.
Oh.
He'll back away. Daisy, protect me, please. Ultimate across.
Not going to do too much.
That was just a warning shot from LWX. And the slow grind right now, Raz, is what we're finding ourselves in. Top lane is not really... getting too much damage onto that tower. Neither is mid lane, but it's bottom lane. The pressure has been turned up.
Yeah, that's a big win for Game Talents. Game Talents gonna go back. Zubin not even gonna go towards the last whisper. I mean, he said that's not gonna happen. Going to the Bloodthirster. He's doing a lot of damage. So right now he's essentially at late game Caitlyn. At this point in time, when he's looking at the enemy team, he's looking across the field. He's thinking, I'm gonna be doing full damage to them. I've got myself a Bloodthirster. I've got a lot of crit. So much crit. He should pretty much be expecting every auto to do just that. So Zubin's doing incredibly well for himself. And that just means that the pressures Republic and Xiaoyu are placing in the front line is that much more valuable.
I think that's like 80% crit right now on him. But he will probably want to get armor penetration at some point regardless.
Yep.
Even just the Giant Slayer is such a good item. Gives you a lot of extra deeps. But we are 1 minute out from another Baron, Mr. Raz. So,
I love those times.
I feel like we've seen a little too many of them today. But
maybe.
They do encourage at least an interesting 30 seconds.
And I just think what's interesting is that Gimgun has found a way to play Rumble to a degree in which he's just completely out-pressuring V. V is playing towards the opposite side of the map. Now he has to play towards him. But he's just getting out pressure, and he doesn't feel too comfortable looking to outright 1v1 Gimgun, especially since he has a lot of gold in his pocket. He can probably just outright burn Jace, and he has the Zhonya's early built up. This is probably a situation he's thought through in Pikmin, where he has Zhonya's where he can actually just burn him through while being completely safe.
I like that you highlight actually that matchup, because it was something we were talking about coming into this game. Xiaoyu gets the knockup onto Mo, and he completely gets blown up there in the jungle. Nothing really to say more about that other than the fact that a redemption comes down and Xiaoyu takes a bit more poke there. Daisy is down. Daisy down.
Yeah, he's out of here. Probably going to come back up fairly soon. But that's actually a really good pickup from Xiaoyu to be able to go for redemption in this situation and say, you know what, we need to fight redemption versus redemption. We don't have the ability to do that with Soulmate. Uh-oh.
I don't know what's going on here, but I don't like it if I'm the side of newbie. LWX gets called out, knocked up, and eliminated from Summoner's Rift. Meanwhile, Coco back behind the Baron pit. Big damage out from V. May even stop the Baron attempt from GT. But if they can pick up another tower, or rather another kill onto Ivan, this will be all worth it for them. Coco finds Gimgun behind him. Comes into the Zhonya's, but it should be a kill there. Flashes over the wall. Gimgun gets alive. Gets out alive, I should say. Doesn't get the kill, but this man... Jack Sparrow has nothing on Gimgun.
Oh, he's trying to lifesteal up as much as possible. Xiaoyu's on his way. But, you know, Coco should be fine if he has a lot of damage, Xiaoyu. Coco is completely fine here, but Game Talents are going to be able to get that same hip.
Everyone was just having a party in mid lane. It's just like, by the way, Soulmate, Zhuvan, and Republic are just taking your inhibitor. The problem that plagued them for the last couple of minutes, they couldn't break this line, and they were just like chilling in mid lane. So GT are in a great position now.
Yeah, and they're going to actually just set back up on this Baron side of the map. Game Talents have been doing so well. Honestly, I wouldn't want to use the words that they're stomping newbie. This is how rough it is.
Yep.
Newbie is a team that took down Xiaogu and took down EDG with the greatest of ease. Not that easy, but was very, like, especially against EDG. But they're having a tough time against Game Talents. Very tough. Actually, they're going to outright lose at this point.
This is a struggle street right now, Raz. Like, I didn't even think they had this much of a problem versus, like, EDG or, like, any of the other teams that they're faced, honestly, in this group. But for some reason, GT just have their number. And sometimes you get that team, you know, that you can deal with the best, but sometimes you just cannot deal.
They were just surprised.
This team.
I think that's what it came down to. They were very much
surprised.
But
twice in a row? Two games in a row?
Yeah. I mean, after the first game, you come into this game, you would not expect how, I would say, well-rounded Xiaoyu has been. He only had a few moments under the rift. and he was able to not only bridge the top side of the map and make it so it wasn't a snowball coming through for Gimgoon, you know, not going to be walked all over, and then goes to the top, bottom side of the map and create a play. He's actually just outplayed Swift the entirety of the game.
That's an accolade you can just take and write down on your CV any day, to be honest. You know, Swift, big, that's big player on this team. You know, especially in terms of how it facilitates, and like, if you had to choose a member on that team, you'd be like, yep, this is Swift team, you know?
Yeah.
And this game, he just hasn't been able to make the Ivan pick work. While Zhao Yu has just been consistent, hasn't died a bunch, died once, 10 assists. Baron being started off by GT, and it's burnt away to the point where Newbie actually need to back away here.
Oh.
Because here comes the equalizer, Moore's caught up in it, he's gonna go down regardless. GT are gonna turn their attention back on towards Coco. He jumps over the wall, that was not the ability he wanted. Yep, Ace in the Hole comes across, and that's more than enough damage to finish him off. The big playmaker's down for the count. LWX and the rest of his team won't need to make themselves scarce.
And LWX, he has a lot of damage, but he's going to have to make a massive play to make this work. He's thinking about it, but right now you know Republic has him in the back of his head. And he is a massive, massive victor at this point in the game. You do not want to look the pressure up on him. With that being said, Xiao Yu is just going to go straight back out to the map. LWX, get out of there.
He doesn't want to go down. He sees the highlight in his eye. But so does Zubin. He's going to jump in there. V doesn't go down, but he dances himself into Swift and LWX. Xiao Yu is there in the front lines now as well. But in your heart out, look at Zubin go. Gets the kill there. Doesn't finish off the next one. But Zubin may have just ended the game right here for GT. And Newbie, the titans of this group. I'm choking on my own words, Raz. G2 take this game 2-0. Over their opponents! What happened?
What happened? What basketball did they suck energy out of? Because for whatever reason, game talents are talented. That was a massive upset for game talents to take this win. Frostgrain already on the plane getting up out of here.
I know.
Expecting this to be over and
turn
done
that playing around. We needed it for the post game.
Yeah, get over here, by the way. That was something. That was such a phenomenal set for game talents. And a phenomenal tilt for Newbie. For them to come back into this game, I mean, game talents, I mean, they took game one, and that felt like, you know, a miracle run. You know what? Mm-hmm. You took that game 60 minutes into the game. I'm not going to buy it. Get that out of my face. Going to game two, and that was such a masterful. Get me a bow. Yeah, there we go.
Bring it in.
That was really good. And I mean, if you're game talents, suddenly Savoki, you're not really tied to him anymore. I mean, that's all.
Yep.
I don't want to. That's not. I mean, it feels too soon to say that.
Just signing a death warrant for Savoki. So I was like, wrap it up. See you later, nerd.
But there is suddenly a lot of competition on that team because you thought that, or at least we all thought, I don't want to put you under that bus. But we thought that Xiaoyu, throwaway. Wu Strong is that jungler. Savoki, you can't. That suddenly you're changing the scope of this team. Who would do that? Put him away. You know, Soulmate makes no sense on this team.
Mm-hmm.
But Soulmate and Xiaoyu, even though they have such a small amount of damage, it doesn't matter. The damage doesn't matter. They set up these three powerful players to go. And game talents take the win.
And that's the biggest thing that you really highlight there, Raz, is the fact that we looked towards these players and it was just like, GT, you had a good thing going for you. Why not just stick with this initial roster where you're taking games away from EDG? And then they swap up the roster and they just murder Newbie, who took out EDG. And it's just like, okay, all right, I guess you knew better than we did. And so did the fans, because they voted that in the fan vote. And we were just like, what are the fans thinking? But they knew. They knew, Raz.
No. Those fans were trolling. I'll tell you right now, those fans knew nothing.
But they knew. They knew it was going to be a 2-0.
Yeah.
They didn't. But it was still a 2-0 in the end. And it was an upset, as you rightly mentioned. Like, I literally wrote in most of my notes coming in today was about EDG. And it's just like, how are they going to come out of this league? But the biggest surprise coming out of the day was definitely GT, and how it wasn't a whitewash in Newbie's direction. It was actually the opposite.
Yeah, that was the greatest upset we've seen in this split so far. That we, I mean,
bigger than the EDG last week.
It had to be. I mean, I feel like that's the case, because if you look at this group, I mean, if you look at the standing, you're thinking Newbie, game talent, they're at the bottom of the rack. Mm-hmm. Get me out of here. This is a low tier game. But Newbie were able. They mean they bring in Coco, they rough up EDG, they smack up Xiaoyu. They're saying we're the best teams. Frostgrain leaves off on a plane saying, you know, who's the best team in this league, or at least in this group? Newbie. And
it's,
I agree with her, because that's the case, right? But game talents coming into this one, it wasn't just a messy game, because technically Newbie had a lot of good points and good showings. It was actually game talents cleaning a lot of their game up. And so, I mean, we've talked about game talents not being so much out of it, even though we kind of signed them off their death warrant.
Yeah.
But we did say that their greatest strength was going to be in their team fighting. But for whatever reason, their early game just popped off. And so that's fantastic to see.
Yeah, I want one more point on this matchup. Got to talk about Kim Goon. Okay. Because look at him, even in this game, he picked the Rumble. He picked it into the matchup as well. He's like, I am confident I can make this work against Jace. And he took far too many towers that should be acceptable on a Rumble.
Yeah.
But he did it anyway, and he made it work. And we haven't got the MVP just yet, but I feel like he was robbed in that first game, and I think this should be a bleed over into
the
second
Zubin
game.
Show. It's the Zubin show.
I know
show.
He was good.
Give me Zubin.
Oh, Republic, what? Okay. Right. I mean, yes, Republic had a great game, but it should have been a two-man race between Zubin and Kim Goon. But all right. He had a good game, but he picked the victor. Yes, he made it work. But did you see Zubin in that final fight? He was running down three people by himself.
He was running them down. That was actually, I'm still hyped up for that one.
Yeah, me too.
I got to relax.
We can keep it up until the end of the show. Yeah, it's just us, Raz. We can be as hype as Rush Hour can be right now.
I was just about to throw this one at the ground. But,
get out of here.
That's too much of an effort. but yeah, that was so fun. And now suddenly you look at Group B, and I'm not going to say that it's up in the air because they have a lot to climb. This could just be a one game win, and it means absolutely nothing for game talents. They need to do this consistently. And the same goes for Newbie, because we talk about them being best in Group B, but you know who was one of the best teams of the league and still in relegations? That was LGD last split. So it doesn't matter how your current strength goes. It consistently means a lot. And if you're consistently inconsistent, then you're not going to be coming out of that position. So.
Consistently inconsistent describes this group, Raz, because we came in and was like, this group is about macro play. We're about team play, about how they come together. The other group, they're just a complete fiesta. And it's like whoever pops off in the game, that's going to decide the game. And then we come into week three, and near the end of it, it's like maybe it was the other way around. So we come into the next couple of weeks, you know, when after IEM we see these cross-group plays, we're actually going to have an entirely different ball game than we were expecting coming into week one and even week two.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really strong point, where both groups felt fairly strong in terms of their identity, saying, you know, Group B is superior in every way.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing about Group A is going to touch Group B. And Group A is just, as you mentioned, a fiesta, but suddenly that doesn't mean much. Mm-hmm. And so going into cross groups, I want to see how game talents go. I think game talents suddenly, even though they were in a tough group and they were struggling, you're going up against Group A, is game talents going to pick a lot of their wins off in that side of the group? It's a big question for me.
That's very true. And, you know, we didn't say on air, but, you know, back in our story meetings earlier on the week, we were talking about, you know, this battle for the throne. Who's going to overthrow EDG and take them out, you know, and get that number one spot? And we were like looking at Group A, and what are they? They're the clown car. Like, everyone's jumping in. It's like, who's going to come out? Who's going to battle themselves out and come out first that clown car? And actually, it was completely, completely different from what we thought. So I'm glad that we got that out there onto air, because we were wrong as, you know, analysts. I'm not an analyst, so I'm going to blame you. Just surprising coming into this. And you didn't throw me under the bus, but I don't have your bag in this one. But I'm just happy to see the fact that there is so much. Everyone's beating everyone, you know, to rephrase that one in Group B. So it's definitely very different. So heading into tomorrow, again, we go back to the other group, but moving forward from now, we actually just need to see how this group settles, because it's in turmoil.
Yeah, competition is very much needed, especially in Group B, because Group A was a big point where everyone is competitive, and that's a really good point for the top teams if they can come out ahead of it. Group B, it felt like at the very beginning that you have the top teams, it was fairly heavy, and then you have game talents, and then maybe newbie. But newbie's starting to pick it up. Game talents apparently is starting to pick it up. We'll have to see if that's something that remains the same. And if suddenly, if you have two groups that are just up in order and everyone's beating each other, that is going to be fun.
Yeah, it will be
very
fun. Yes, but what does that mean for the region? Because we have to always go back to the original point, was like, we're rebuilding. You know, we're getting back to the point where let's look at these international events. Maybe not IEM, but closer to like MSI. Like, how are we going to compete? And if we're looking at these teams where everyone's beating everyone, and you look at Group B, and it's just like, oh, EDG's had just a bad day. Newbie, they just had a bad day.
I think that we're looking at the groups, and I mean, this is exactly what we're talking about, right? Where all of these teams right here, as you mentioned, what does this actually mean? Mm-hmm. I think this is a good point, because at first I didn't buy that rebuilding point. I think a lot of these teams, I didn't know how they were going to grow, but RNG has grown a lot. EDG has grown just a bit. Chaogu newbie, game talents, they're all growing to a point where suddenly if you go into an international competition, not so much, let's say, next week, but in the future compositions with MSI being slated to go to Brazil, and of course, World's going to be in China. That's going to be fun. That's a long, long road, but rebuilding is a long process, and so far with a lot of these teams, it's starting to come out.
Absolutely. We can see the schedule for tomorrow as well, starting off the day with Snake OMG, followed by IMA IG and RNG LGD to finish off that one. And you just saw on the schedule that OMG were at the bottom of that group, but everyone else was just tied up in the middle. And that just completely describes our league right now.
And even OMG, even though they were solidly at the bottom, are starting to play to a certain degree where they can take wins. So overall, these teams, I mean, I'm looking for week four and looking who can take it.
Yeah, for sure. Because we honestly just do not know which way the wind will take us, because someone has a bad day and suddenly someone in the middle of the pack just accelerates to the top. It literally could go anywhere, Raz. Any closing statements before we finish today?
I mean, even though I talked about week four, there's still another day. There's still Sunday.
That's true.
And I'm going to be there all day for
it. Oh, yes.
Woo! So that's going to be fun. Tune in for that one Sunday here.
Look forward to that one, and that will do it. So on that note, we will close the social. Thank you very much for watching. On behalf of myself, Raz, for sticking with me all day today as well, we're going to send it off for tonight. So make sure to tune in again tomorrow for more League of Legends action.